in this edition of Art Loft. Watercolors come to life in Isla Morada.
Recently, I went down to the turtle hospital, and so right now I'm working on a green turtle that I got to meet while I was down at the turtle hospital.
Music students take on the Duke.
One of the things that Ellerton has done is help the young people to really develop confidence.
Freestyle poetry that rocks.
I came up with this idea last year and it worked really well. And we do an online performance of poetry by rock musicians.
Bluegrass music finds a home in the Florida Keys.
I was approached because I love this style of music and they wanted kind of a new thing, so the director of Isla Morada Community Entertainment approached me to do a bluegrass festival for them, so I decided to do it.
Sculpture weaves through a community.
I think public art is incredibly important because it reflects whatever is going on in society.
And a comedic jewelry heist. It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years. And
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
Hi, I'm Kaylin James, and from the Eleazar Delgado Studio at McCormick Place, this is Art Loft. Welcome to our show. Our first story takes us to the northern region of the Florida Keys in Isla Morada, where artist Michelle Nicole Lowe creates watercolor paintings inspired by a long family history of life near the ocean. Take a look.
I think I first fell in love with the ocean. I'm fascinated by the colors you can find underwater in fish and coral. I've loved drawing and painting my whole life since I was a little girl, and I love painting the underwater world. In college, I studied finance and did the business route in college, and then I worked in corporate finance for 2 years, and the only painting that I did during those 6 years was this colorful tarpon that I have in my gallery now. I can tell every painting that I do, I'm improving on knowing the paint and the colors and how they fuse together. And so to know every single variation of every color and how they're going to interact is something that just comes with experience. And I think I've gotten a lot better at it as I've kept painting. I've painted in oils and acrylics, and I just don't enjoy it as much as I enjoy watercolor. Something about the flow of the water and the paint, it works for me. I don't know if it has a relation with because of the ocean and water and how it looks. I'm not exactly sure, but oils and acrylics just kind of move too slowly for me. I usually see something and then I'll do a few sketches and kind of get an idea of the composition that I want to do and go for the painting. Recently, I went down to the turtle hospital, and so right now I'm working on a green turtle that I got to meet while I was down at the turtle hospital. I think the queen sugarfish is my favorite fish out of all of the series of fish faces. I've used it for my sign and advertising, and it's really colorful, and it's got lines around its eye that kind of, it gives it a girly attitude, and I like that one a lot. It makes me really calm and at peace when I'm painting, and I think it's needed. It's kind of like some people need yoga. I need to be able to paint.
Lo often exhibits her work during Isla Morada's monthly art walks, but you don't have to wait that long. Log on to michellenicolelo.com for more information, or you can visit fla-keys.com for the ultimate in Florida Keys arts and culture.
Myself, I'll do some interesting songs that I like, that I feel the words are strong.
Each year, students from across the country travel to the Big Apple to duke it out. Musically, that is, at the Essentially Ellington High School Jazz Band Competition, held in New York City's Lincoln Center. Dillard Center for the Arts in Fort Lauderdale has taken top honors in past years, so we caught up with the band's director and his students to learn more.
This is my 10th year at Dillard, and in the beginning it was difficult because I had to, you know, develop a culture, I had to develop an environment, but I'm happy to say that like maybe 5 years after being at Dillard and working and putting things in place, we're moving in the right direction.
So, rhythm section. What we're gonna do is we're gonna be vibing and we're gonna be grooving, all right? And I'll be like, you know, I'll say stuff to you guys. You guys just play. You do whatever you wanna do. Okay, we're gonna follow you.
When a student is studying music, they're gonna use both sides of their brain. They have to become creative, okay? And when you become creative, academically, they normally excel or they start excelling because of the discipline that is needed to be a musician.
Mr. Dorsey just really wants to see his students that he gets as young teenagers, he wants to see them grow into adults. I think he just does a great job of shaping people, and he's sure shaped me.
He tells you straight up, he tells you how things are, and but you know, he's not the guy who'll just sit there and like help you and say, okay, this is exactly what you do, but he kind of leads you to it though. So he'll say, you know, Anthony, you gotta work on your tone, and you gotta work on Clark studies.
This is our fifth year coming to Ellerton. The first year we made Ellerton was in 2010. And I'll never forget when we made Ellerton, we were just happy to be here, okay? And I think one of the things that Ellerton has done is help the young people to really to develop confidence.
I was kind of oblivious my first year because I was a freshman. I didn't know what was going on. And I wasn't really a part of the band. I just got in the band. I was 14 years old. And it seems like I grew more mature as I came here during the years.
I started playing in sixth grade. My mom, she told me I should play trumpet because my great grandpa, he played trumpet. So she said I should play trumpet. I didn't want to do it. I wanted to play basketball. Okay. But I'm kind of short, so you know, that wasn't the best thing for me. So I started playing trumpet, and at first I didn't like it, but eventually I grew to love it after hearing Freddie Hubbard play. So I just started practicing for hours and hours and hours. I got trumpet lessons, then I went to Dillard Center for the Arts, and then I got to do things like go to New York, and that, you know, opened my mind to what's out there musically.
The most important lesson I learned over the 4 years is the lesson of family and working together with people. Because I feel like in a lot of bands, it kind of becomes a thing of I'm here and you're there. You kind of get separated. But a big thing that happens in our band is that despite some people being at an extremely high level and some people still being at a high level but not as high, that we still find that balance of connecting as people and coming together as a band so we can have fun and swing.
Over the 4 years, I think I've really changed as a person and as a musician, of course. Just learning from Mr. Dorsey and learning from students around me, I've began to like teaching others, and I feel like the things that the seniors passed on to me when I was a freshman, I'm now trying to pass on to the freshmen now.
One of of the things that I want to take from Ellerton is, first of all, is the fact that we're around like-minded people. You know, they're playing on stage in front of an appreciative audience, first of all, because everybody that's in there, they appreciate what's being done. And this is one of the only places where you're going to be able to take your young people that are between the ages of 14 and 18 that are doing the same thing they're doing. The next thing is a learning experience for them. Another thing is they get to hear different bands. They get to hear the personalities of those different bands. And then they also get a chance to see that they have a personality. And they have a personality that is good. It's a good personality in our band. They're learning how to get along with their own peers in their own band, but they also learn how to get along with other kids because they're out there mingling, talking to other bands. It's a competition, and yes, everybody wants to win. You know what I'm saying? But the great thing about the festival, for the most part, it's learning. It's a learning situation for all these young people.
Dillard placed third this year. If you'd like to learn more, log on to dillardhigh.com or jalc.org for details on the Essentially Ellington program.
We play what we like to call outlaw bluegrass. We change a few of the traditions of the genre and bend them the way we want to, you know, and it's slightly different.
We first met Frank Falestra during last year's International Noise Conference in Miami. Well, Frank's back, and he's at the helm of Poetry That Rocks, an open mic poetry project that's held in a rock club environment. We traveled to South Florida's iconic Churchill's Pub in Little Haiti to speak with Falestra and learn more about this Anything Goes poetry event.
Tonight is we're going to do an Oh Miami event where we're going to have Poets That Rock. These are rock musicians and people who do music that are going to come and do poetry. Some others will be doing like a cappella songs without music.
Stop it, never code it, that my sound harms, that understands, that be you and me forever.
I came up with this idea last year and it worked really well. And we do an online performance of poetry by rock musicians. They're generally either rock musicians or just people that come to the bar, you know, and maybe people not musicians, they just hang out at Churchill's and they may want to step up and do some poetry. It's a kind of an open mic.
Where bums lie asleep in their piss. They must be someone's lost love. Sleeping outside clubs where I would dance in the dark with faceless boys dressed as men.
And I think a lot of musicians, one of the key things of a song, one of the key items of a song is the lyrics. And lyrics are basically a form of poetry.
Yeah, nothing.
One of my favorite is Kenny Millions. He's done poetry for many years. He used to be a really good friend of John Cage, and he does some really great, been to some really great free jazz events. He's a great musician, great horn player, but he's dabbed into some poetry. And
he started to laugh hysterically.
Myself, I'll do some interesting songs that I like, that I feel the words are strong. Plus, it's an open mic. We kept it for anyone to show up. We're usually surprised by some really great talent.
She will not see.
For us, it's great to have the opportunity to have local musicians that really will put their lyrics out and their words up front.
And walked up on the edge of no escape. She said, I've lost control.
Oh Miami hosts Poetry That Rocks and other literary events throughout the city. Their mission is to advance literacy culture in the greater Miami area. For details on this, log on to omiami.org or visit sculptures.com to watch videos on poetry readings at Churchill's.
The material that you're looking at on the surface is all from a turn of the century, I guess like 1900s, cotton gin.
Bluegrass music has its roots steeped in Appalachian tradition, but this isn't your grandfather's tune. The Baygrass Bluegrass Festival in the Upper Florida Keys features contemporary bands with young musicians. We return to the island community of Isla Mirada to meet some of the artists.
I was approached because I love this style of music and they wanted kind of a new thing, so the director of Isla Mirada Community Entertainment approached me to do a bluegrass festival for them, so I decided to do it. Appalachian roots music, you know, it's the music that was brought here by our ancestors and kind of developed in the United States because of everybody's different backgrounds, you know, and before we all had TVs and video games and cell phones, this is what people did. You know, people hung out and played music. So there's lots of people around the festival hanging out playing music as well.
We play what we like to call outlaw bluegrass. We change a few of the traditions of the genre and bend them the way we want to, you know, and it's slightly different. We try to keep our instrumentation and our vocal styles and everything traditional while veering away from tradition with our lyrics, you know. So the tradition is something to me to be respected, but not necessarily a roadmap. It's like a foundation that you can build upon. Yeah, I just hope it's people find it exciting, and you know, I think I try to write music that you would want to drive fast to. I mean, that's basically my goal when writing music, you know, and that's when I listen to music the most, is when I'm in my car. And so if someone finds it exciting, then I feel like I've done my job.
Yeah, we're more like blue music.
We came down here last year after playing a bluegrass cruise, and just kind of fell in love with the place. You know, it's just got a really nice vibe about it, and they seem to just really love their music down here. And so the guy who put on this festival here, Robbie, asked us on back, and we were happy to come on back down. So yeah, that's how we got introduced to it. I'm glad to be back.
I think because we do mostly original material, you know, it's not really considered traditional, but I think that people that like old time and bluegrass and traditional music really seem to like our music as well. You know, it kind of crosses over because that's a lot of what we listen to.
It's a churchyard auction, sight to see.
You know, it seems to be in a lot of these sort of smaller communities, you meet really nice people who are really eager to just like spend time with you, not just come to the show and listen to the songs, but actually get to hang out with people and talk with them. And I think that was what we really identified with the last time we were here, and it made us excited to come back.
A house of stone.
For more information on this festival, log on to baygrassbluegrass.com or visit fla-keys.com for the ultimate in Florida Keys arts and culture. In this next segment, we stop by Houston, Texas, where an entire neighborhood pitched in to help an artist realize his creative vision. And it was certainly a tall order, 180 feet to be precise. Take a look.
This is Montrose Boulevard, which of course is a main arts corridor from Allen Parkway on up to the CAM, the MFA. So this is a really ideal central location that we're at, where the Art League Houston is sited. There's a fair amount of traffic that comes by each day, so it's great to have something so visible, you know, on a thoroughfare. That is Funnel Tunnel. It was created from a steel armature woven with recycled painted wood. It's 180 feet long, and it's fairly consistently 5 feet in diameter all the way through the tail end, which tapers to a point, and then on the other end it flows out into a 12-foot diameter bell or horn. So there are four trees on the median laid out in kind of a zigzag pattern. And I wanted to make sure that this was in concert with that. You know, maybe it had a conversation that happened with those trees and also with the traffic and with the neighborhood in general, and kind of spoke to the energy of the neighborhood. It's just made out of two varieties of steel stock, which is a 3/8 inch round rod and 1/4 inch round rod. So it's a very light framework that we've created. And what that looked like was building these sort of noodles, 5-foot diameter tubes, basically with a very gentle bend. And we made about 14 or 16 of those to the points where it changes shape at the end. So one end is tapered into kind of a hook, like a scorpion's tail. And the other end, it bells out into a cone or sort of a trumpet. And so the idea there is that each end is unique and serves a different function. The hooked end was intended to point here to the art league. For me, the interest in the bell or the cone end was to sort of serve as like an announcement, but also maybe to draw in people's attention. So just a fun way to play with form. After the framework was complete, it became possible to start weaving the material in. So the material that you're looking at on the surface is all from a turn of the century, I guess like 1900s, cotton gin, which, you know, I didn't realize anything like that was still around. And so I got all these beautiful, huge, old growth pine planks that I started ripping them into very thin 1/4 inch strips that were then flexible and able to be woven into the surface. So after I created this bulk of ripped material, I brought it over to the Art League here. I actually used the Texas Art Supply parking lot, which is right next door, and sponsored a painting party where people from the community could come and they could really put their creative mark on it. So it was of huge interest to me that you know, we'd be able to literally have the community show up in the project. It feels great to really draw on the energy of others and to get input too. So like the form was predetermined, but the surface was by no means known to me what that would look like. The color is based on a large number of paints that were left over from people. I was asking for people to give me, you know, like odds and ends that they had laying around in their garage or whatever. And we also had a really nice donation from the Valspar paint company. I guess it's uniformly chaotic on the surface, so it somehow works. There's been a lot of like wonderful conversations and great reactions that people have given, you know, about the project. And so some people have said, is this supposed to be like a bird's head on the end where, you know, where it tapers, or is it a snake, is it a dragon, what is it, you know? And for me, it's like, well, I'm interested in what it looks like to you, you know? Like I just made the form. It was sort of an intuitive form. And beyond that, whatever is associated with it, great. I think public art is incredibly important because it reflects whatever's going on in society. It can either be something just a pure pleasure, or maybe it can catalyze conversation around different issues. And I think that's really fascinating. And my favorite thing is when people from the neighborhood say, we love this, because after all, they're the ones that have to see it most often. So I'm happy to know that they, you know, they like what's there.
To learn more about this community arts program and the artists behind the tunnel, visit artleaguehouston.org.
This is a 10,000 square foot exhibition that is all about Sherlock Holmes, the character, the evolution of the character from an idea in Conan Doyle's mind all the way up to present day, and also a look at the forensic science that Holmes used in order to come up with his deductions.
Finally tonight, two thieves square off over a fancy mustache in this animated comedy from directors Eric Kuncha and Seung Sung. An official selection from last year's MIA animation, here's Marcel. For more information on tonight's directors, enter SeungSung.com or MarcelMovieTumblr.com. And remember, this year's MIA Animation Conference takes place October 10th and 11th. Registration to compete is still open, so don't delay. Visit MIAAnimation.com. Well, that's our show this week. Visit WPBT2.org/ArtLoft to watch past episodes and be sure to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and now Instagram at ArtLoftSFL. Thanks so much for watching. I'm Kaylin James reminding you to stay creative. Bye. About this anything goes poetry. Come here, puppy. Come here, Pixie. Come here. Are you okay? We have a new host. It's me and Pixie. Say hello. Can you say stay creative? Say stay creative. I feel like I was blinking my eyes a lot, but it could just be me.
We got a safety in case you want to do that.
We need another safety?
No.
Okay. I'm fine. Right. If you didn't notice anything weird, but do if you see me. Are you watching me?
Yeah.
Okay. Did my eyes look weird? Okay. Your eyes don't look weird either. So you know.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation. Newman's Own, giving all profit to charity and pursuing the common good for over 30 years. And
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.